Good afternoon. Please have a seat. We'd like to welcome you to the second part of this four-part union session on results from the Tohoku Oki earthquake. We're going to have one invited talk, which will go for a little bit longer, for 23 minutes, and then all subsequent speakers, we will have 15 minutes. The light will start flashing 2 minutes before the end at 13 minutes. Okay. Our first presentation today, this afternoon, is entitled The Crustal Deformations Due to the Great March 11th Earthquake, Tohoku Oki Earthquake, and Their Tectonic Implications, presented by Kato Aoki and Fukada and Tanaka.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Before going into my talk, I'd like to say a few words. In abstract, we have only three authors, but I'd like to add one more author, Toshiyuki Tanaka, who contributed to my talk in terms of viscoelastic modeling. And also, I'd like to acknowledge Geospatial Information Authority of Japan, Japan Coast Guard, and Tohoku University, who kindly provided us for their data for this research. Okay, now going to the next slide. My talk is concerned with crustal deformation due to the Tohoku earthquake. And first, I'd like to show the results of core seismic crustal deformation and its the derived slip distribution. I believe most of you have already looked at some of modeling results, but we also show you our own results, which is very important, at least the initial condition to the post-seismic crustal deformation. And maybe I will add some comments to the core seismic crustal deformation analysis. And then we are talk about post-seismic crustal deformation and its results of time-dependent inversion analysis. And we add some more information on the viscoelastic relaxation modeling results. And I would like to add some discussion on tectonic implications, but those discussions are mostly distributed in the those talks on the post-seismic displacement and its modeling. Okay. And first, I'd like to talk about the core seismic crustal deformation. And we used not just the GeoNet data, but we also used seven GPS caustic data, which shows a big crustal deformation at the sea floor. And we analyzed GeoNet data using GPC OASIS software, and we made a kinematic analysis using 1 hertz sampling data. This is necessary because at the same day of the main shock, the largest aftershock occurred only 30 minutes after the main shock. So in order to segregate the effect of the main shock and the largest aftershock, we had to use kinematic analysis. And the displacement for this core seismic, the main shock and the largest aftershock was estimated by averaging 10 minutes before and after the event. And we made some geodetic inversion analysis that is usually done by other authors. And we, as a geometry, we used a curved plate interface modeled by paved triangular elements. So this is the analyzed crustal deformation data. And as you see, you may already know that more than 5 meters of horizontal offset was observed due to the main shock. And also more than 1 meter of subsidence was estimated. Here is some inset picture. It shows how it looked like when we visited the site of Ojika site, that is shifted more than 5 meters. The person standing here, she is my friend, Jessica Mare Moreira of U.S. Geological Survey. And I asked her to stand there to show where the original position of GeoNet site was. So you may feel that how large was the displacement here. Actually, it's very difficult to see how large the horizontal displacement was when we visited there. However, if you think about the vertical deformation, its effect is very evident. The right-hand side inset picture is taken at the very nearest fishery port, only several hundred meters from this Gionet site. And the, in this picture, you see that the pier submerged underneath the sea surface so that the pier cannot be used by the fishermen living there. So the vertical displacement has a very big impact to the even to the society or economical situation. So one more one of the questions raised is if this kind of subsidence will be recovered afterwards. So we have to answer this kind of question. Well, this is the core seismic crust movements due to the largest aftershock. We have to, please be careful about the scale here, which is more than one order of magnitude smaller than the main shock. But still, this is pretty large, and the magnitude of the largest aftershock is magnitude 8, which is usual large interplate earthquake, and which is very important because this largest aftershock occurred pretty close to the metropolitan area of Tokyo. So this has a very big impact to the to that region. And this is the obtained results so far, and you may have already seen the similar type of kind of maps. I use a pointer. Okay. So as you see, there is a big localized area of big large displacement, and as you see here is the ocean bottom displacement data that shows more than 30 meters displacement. So the estimated slip amounts to more than 50 meters here. And also, here is the largest aftershock, and which is only 2 or 3 meters slip here. Okay. This is the kind of consistent results with other results. The one thing I'd like to comment is that this kind of results is rather robust because we use the ocean bottom crustal deformation data. If we do not use the ocean bottom crustal deformation data, the result becomes rather unstable, depending on what kind of boundary condition you used. That this is one shown here. There is a comparison between red marks and blue colors. And the blue colors is a case where when we do not use the ocean bottom data. So the result looks very different from that. And if we change the boundary conditions, the results will be very much different. But as far as we use the ocean bottom crustal deformation data, then the result will be more robust. In order to check this, I compared our results with other studies' results with using the same data. What I mean is GeoNet data and ocean bottom data. So these three studies are nearly the same in terms of data. And they mostly show the identical results, which means that the large slip is very much concentrated to the shallowest part of the plate interface, and which is very much consistent with seismological results. But a little more comprehensive study was done by Inmar and others. They will show a poster on Friday morning, so you can visit their posters. And they used not only our data, but also they used ocean bottom pressure sensors. So this is their data results, and basically these are the same. However, their results showed that the maximum slip went up more than 80 meters. So this kind of results, I'm not sure which is the case, but very localized, very large slip may show that this area might have deformed inelastically, not just elastically. So if actually this area showed deformation of inelastic deformation, then our analysis might not be adequate. So probably in the future, we need to elaborate our core seismic modeling also, considering such inelastic deformation. Now move on to the post-seismic cluster deformation. And before going into the real data, I want to say something about what the post-seismic cluster deformation is and what problem do we have. As you may already know, that the number of modeling for post-seismic mechanism of are proposed. The first one is a slip on the deeper extension of plate interface. And also, as Paul Siegel indicated in the previous talk, that the viscoelastic effect would be very significant. And also some other possibilities like displacement by aftershocks or a poroelastic deformation could be considered. But here, I would like to concentrate only on the transient slip at the deeper interface of the plate, and also viscoelastic relaxation. Now, question is, will the core seismic subsidence be recovered by the post-seismic cluster movements? As I told you, this kind of very large subsidence has a very big social or economic impact. So people expect that that subsidence may be recovered. I'm very frequently asked this question by media or many other people. So we have to answer them. But not only just that kind of question, there is a very significant scientific meaning of this question. Here is a mystery. Why does the northeastern Pacific coast of Japan subside? Well, mystery means that there's a problem that has not been solved by myself, where anyone else could have already some solution. But what we say is that while coastal terrace here suggests that uplift in the recent quaternary age of something like 100,000 years, however, geodetic data shows very stable, stationary subsidence in the recent 100 years. So how can we reconcile these discrepancies? Well, sorry, this is a little bit difficult to read for you, but the quaternary data suggests that there is a slight uplift along this coast with about 0.5 millimeter per year. However, if you look at the leveling of recent 70 or 80 years, then the northeastern part of Pacific coast shows very rapid subsidence of several millimeters a year. And this is more recent tidal gauge data, and that shows very stationary subsidence. As you see here, this is 1955, and this is 2009. So you may expect that if this subsidence is due to the plate coupling and plate dragging and drag down the coast, then the rebounding large earthquake may recover the uplift. However, this is not the case. Even before the Tohoku earthquake, there have been a number of interplate earthquakes here. And for example, in 1978, Miyagi-Oki earthquake occurred, but here, as you see, there was a subsidence. And another one in 2005 also subsided the region. So what's the mechanism to rebound this, to reconcile the uplift of in the quaternary age? There is one hypothesis that might solve this problem. The Sawai and others proposed that after a big earthquake, interplate earthquake, a large slow slip occurs at the downward extension of the plate interface by analyzing the tsunami deposit data in the eastern part of Hokkaido. So this is still a hypothesis. So the Tohoku earthquake may have provided us a very good chance to to solve this problem. Of course, we have not yet observed what's going, but still it's worth trying to solve this problem. So first, we first try to begin with a very simple modeling. How much sleep should we need to recover the core seismic subsidence? If we assume that only 2.5 meter of sleep is given at the deeper extension from 40 to 90 kilometer of depth, then the coastal uplift could be about 1 meter, which recovers total core seismic sleep. So this could be a very good, solution to our problem. So then let's go to the real data. Now what we have done is first we analyze GPS data, and we used daily daily data and get solutions using PPP analysis using GPC software. And we used data from March 11 to October 17, about 7 months after the earthquake. And we used a time-dependent inversion technique first proposed by Seeger and Matthews. And model space is the same as core seismic data. Now, this is the results after 7 months of after the core seismic day. Now, as you see, the post-seismic deformation displacement is rather large distributed. And one thing, as you see here, the scale is, this is 50 centimeter. So as you may see how big is the post-seismic displacement. And also for the vertical movement, in the Miyagi area, there are some uplift, but northern Iwate is still subsiding. And one more thing you could notify is that there is some significant displacement in the Boso area, which is the southern extension of the source area, which may be somewhat important. Well, this is just a sample time series plots at the Iwate site. And this is east-west component, so this this is north-south. So this site moves mostly east or a little bit south-east-south. East-south-east. And the vertical displacement shows a little bit subsidence, but this shows very beautiful transient displacement. And this is in the Miyagi Prefecture. And here you see a little bit uplift here. And this is another one. And this is summing up taking up the vertical displacement from north to south. And still the vertical displacement is only 10 centimeter or 15 centimeter at most. So compared with a core seismic subsidence, only 10% or 2% of subsidence may have recovered so far. And this is accumulated post-seismic sleep estimate from our time-dependent inversion analysis. And as you see, the post-seismic sleep is taking place at the lower extension, deeper extension of the core seismically slipped region, as you may have already anticipated. And the amount of sleep is something like 2.5 meters at the central part of sleeping area. One more thing we should notify is that there is another area of post-seismic sleep nearby Boso Peninsula. You could see some other small areas, but I think this could be some artifact due to the model space, the boundary of the model space. Now, this is a snapshot of the post-seismic sleep. As you see, this is March 11 to about 10 days after the March 11, and goes like this, progressed like this. And one thing we have a little bit puzzled is that we first expected that the sleep moved from shallower place to the deeper interface. But as far as we see, it's not the case. It seems that the central part, this centroid of the sleeping region does not move very much. We are still working on this, and we might think that this might be due to that the result is very much weighted to the horizontal displacement, and vertical displacement still very small, so that there could be some misfit to the vertical displacement. We are not sure yet the real results, real reason of this, but we should work on this for a while. And this is the temporal plot of how the equivalent magnitude estimated from the moment analysis. This is a little bit different by the assuming different elastic constant, but if we, generally speaking, the equivalent magnitude went up to 8.4 or 8.5 at this moment. Now, if we think what happens in the future, how large the magnitude could be for this post-seismic slow event. And if you wait until 10 years, 100 years, and 1,000 years, then the magnitude could be bigger than 9.3. But of course, this may not be so realistic. This is just for the analysis. But a more serious situation is a vertical displacement. If we fit the vertical motion to the logarithmic functions, as people usually do, what happens is that after 1 year, uplift could be about 10 centimeters. Then in 10 years, it could be 14 centimeters, and it moves up to 30 centimeters or so, even after 10,000 years. So the conclusion from here is that this site will never recover the core seismic subsidence of 1.1 meter only by post-seismic slip. So we need some help to recover this core seismic subsidence. So I asked Dr. Tanaka, who is doing some viscoelastic modeling. As is usual, when we employ the viscoelastic modeling, as was suggested by Paul Siegel, usually we use the surface elastic layer on the top of the infinite viscoelastic layer, which is usually modeled by Maxwell fluid. This is also taken from Randall's figure just for simplicity of view. What we see here is at the time of core seismic displacement, this is the continental side goes up and oceanic side subsides a little bit. That pushes the pushes down the viscoelastic mantle, and this side goes up. So due to this kind of stress application, the ground displacement becomes like this with a certain times after the earthquake, and it progresses because the mantle material flows to horizontally. Now, in our case, the sandy coast may be somewhere here. So it's a little bit tricky if sandy coast may uplift or subside. So it depends on the modeling. So it's a little bit difficult task to find the real good results. What we have done so far is that we used theory developed by Tanaka and others, which is a spherical symmetric self-gravitating viscoelastic earth, and the elasticity and density is prem. And viscosities of radius are shown below. On the top of 30 kilometers, crust is purely elastic, and the from 30 to 300 kilometers of depth is assumed as 10 to 19 Pascal second of viscosity. And lower than that is assumed as 10 to 21 Pascal second. And then by this modeling, and this is only show you, I just show you the vertical accumulated vertical displacement. And the the subsiding area is shown as a little bit dark blue. And as you see here, the area of here, including the Sandic coast, subsides. As this is accumulated vertical movement, so this is 10 years after the earthquake, it's still nearly several 10 centimeters subsidence. But if we wait until 100 years after the earthquake, then the coast may be very marginal. It's close to zero, a little bit negative, or some part could be uplift a little bit. But then the subside again. If you take some point and think, shows the temporal evolution, it is something like this. Okay, from here, about one, first, then it uplifts, and then gradually subsides, and recovers again. So it's really difficult to anticipate what goes on. So I will summarize my talk. First, maybe time is up, so I stop here, but one thing is that our trial is still in very preliminary, and we need to elaborate our model very much. And the Tohoku earthquake may provide us a very good chance for us to think about this kind of question to be solved. Thank you very much.
We have time for one quick question. Okay, great. Thank you. Move on. The next talk is entitled Afterslip of the Magnitude 7.3 Foreshock and Triggering of Magnitude 9 Mainshock, Analysis of Seismicity and Numerical Modeling by Ando and Imanishi.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Ryo Ando, and today I'm going to talk about the foreshock mainshock sequence based on the same seismic observation and a bit of the geodetic observation, and also this want to discuss on the physical basis behind this foreshock mainshock sequence. The co-author is Kaz Imanish. Let me begin with some overview of my talk. Foreshock. Okay, the largest foreshock having the moment magnitude of 7.3 occurred 2 days earlier from the mainshock. The location of the hypocenter of foreshock here is about 40 kilometers away from the mainshock here. And as we see later, the aftershock of a foreshock migrate slowly toward the mainshock hypocenter in this direction. So the contour underlaid on this seismicity is co-seismic sweep embedded by the Yoshida-san using a strong motion. And the location of these two hypocenter is located a little bit deeper than the area of the concentrated slip here. And looking back the previous earthquake back to the 60s to the now, those dots, gray dots show the small earthquakes. And looking at these events, the most of the earthquake very actively occur down deep portion of these two hypocenter areas. But this area looks a little bit quiet in the activity of the earthquake. But some exceptions happened on the 1981. We found a swarm-like sequence occurred here, which marked by this arrow starts, sorry, it's a little bit small, but this such sequence involving magnitude 6 to 7 events occur here. So By observing such observation and theory, we presume that the after sleep of the foreshock probably triggered the main shock. And but unfortunately, this slow sleep between the foreshock and the main shock does not appear to be the press sweep or nucleation process of the magnitude 9 earthquake. So basic discussion and the data, seismic data, is already published in this paper, EPS paper for the special issue for Tohoku earthquake. So please refer it for the detail. So this is our seismic analysis. So to see the details of the aftershock migration, we just use the W difference relocation using the standard algorithm provided by Waldhausen and Ellsworth. And we just use the data, we use phase readings by GMA. So the black dot circle in this panel shows the original GMA hypocenters, and the red one and also the blue stars are those relocated. So this changed a little bit. And looking at the depth section and along the distance x here and x dash here in this along this. So relocated hypocenter appears to be localized on this plane. This is, should be the plate interface. And only looking at this green area, which shows aftershock migration, so such a localized feature becomes much clearer. And this is a most remarkable result from our analysis. So this slide shows the epicentral distribution of the aftershocks of the foreshock. So colors show the time after the occurrence of the foreshock. So red color shows the occurrence time of the foreshock, so hypocenter here. And blue color shows the occurrence time of the main shock. So it takes more than 51 hours. And looking at the gradual changes of the color, so you can see the gradual migration of the these aftershocks in this direction. So colors change from red and the concentrated events occurring here, and gradually changing to the yellow and the blue. So please note that there is an overprinted events, later occurred events. So blue have to be located here. These are the aftershocks of the small aftershocks. So we in the original paper, we presume the foreshock focal area located here because of the dense distribution of the early aftershocks. But later, the geodetic inversion shows some extension of the focal area in this way. So, anyways, it doesn't change the, our conclusion, but migration starts from the focal area for the foreshock and migrate down to the hypocenter of the main shock. So this is another evidence of that we are looking at our plate interface aftershocks. So please see the, these shallow dipping reverse fold mechanism, which are determined by the FNET group of the NYED Japan. So this is an interesting result of the, from the Tohoku University group. This is a geodetical inverted after sleep distribution. They use the GeoNet data on shore based, and they also include the ocean bottom barometer data. And they inverted the after-sleep distribution on this area, contour shown by red. And this is what we exactly expected from our aftershock distribution analysis. So the dense distribution of the aftershock located here, which are early aftershocks, but the migration mainly occur in this direction, so it overlapped. So this slide is given by Ota-san, Tokyo University, and he has a Friday AM poster, so please visit his poster for the detail. He's better known than me. So the migration pattern can be much clearer by this space-time plot. So the horizontal axis shows the distance from the main shock hypocenter, and the vertical axis shows the time after the foreshock. So, and the red circle shows the earthquake events taken from this box area, and the green circle here is correspond to the events in here. So, foreshock hypocenter located here, and we presume the area of the focal foreshock focal area here. So we see this gradual migration of the aftershock of the foreshock, and finally, as this migration reached to reach the main shock hypocenter location, the exactly the time the main shock occurred. But the important thing I want to mention here is there is a deceleration of the migration. Okay, so as we fit the migration by linear, it doesn't explain these data points. But by fitting the parabolic fitting by the parabolic line here, we can describe these all important data points. And interestingly, the coefficient of the parabolic curve is in the order of magnitude of 10 to 4 meters square meter per second. So please note that the deceleration of the migration is also supported by the Kato-san's analysis. He showed the results at the SSGI meeting this year. And he detected a much larger number of the aftershocks. And what is the interesting thing? We obtained a 10 to 4 square meter per second. This is very close to the number of the parabolic migration at we observed at the deep portion of the Nankai trough. This is a famous result from Ide, 2010. He observed such a parabolic migration, non-volcanic tremor associated with a short-term sweep event. And this number is quite similar to our finding at the Tohoku Okasuke foreshock aftership. So we find a similar process had occurred in 1981. So during this event, initial event occurred at June 18 here, magnitude 6.1, and then trigger this one, and this one, and this is the largest events in this swarm-like sequence. And after the 4 days, this event occurred. So similarly, plotting the this hypocenter on the space distance from the magnitude 6, this event, and time, so we see the similar parabolic can fit the data. And the interesting thing is the number of the D, which is again the 10 to 4. So this is a very similar number. So we think as a physical background, this area is merely decoupled and the slow seep propagate and as an aftership in this way, which is very similar to the current Tohoku earthquake foreshock sequence. So this is a schematic diagram showing such an interpretation. So we basically consider the coupled patches shown by dark gray. And as a background, we assume the this kind of decoupled and stable areas. And once the foreshock and seismic spectra are here, then after sleep propagate on the stable area. And because we assume this smaller scale of the brittle patches, these are triggered by the after sleep propagation. And finally, it reaches to the main shock hypocenter area, which also can be a combination of these small patches, but it triggered the main shock. That's what we considered. So realization, physical realization of this event can be done by the assuming the photoconstitutive law, and that is described in this way. So we just assume the very simplified way. We for the coupled patches, we only assume the slip velocity weakening behavior, and for the ductile area, so we assume the linear velocity strengthening behavior. So this is a preliminary result from our modeling. Please note that this is a preliminary result, so not in real scale. But you can assume the foreshock area here, which has a higher stress, initial stresses, and main shock area is located here. It's actually exactly not in the real scale, but they have two separated patchy area. So, and after the occurrence of the foreshock, you can see the gradual propagation of the aftersleep, and then it triggered main shock like that. Okay, again, it propagated and then triggering the smaller earthquakes, and it again triggered the main shock. Okay, the parabolic migration can be much clearer by projected to the time along strike distance, and the color show the slip rate average, and you can see the foreshock rupture and the gradual propagation of the source. Maybe not clear on this video, but you can see that these are smaller earthquakes, aftershocks. So the important discussion may be the pre-slip or after-slip distinction of these two. I'm sorry. But we consider the what we observe is a deceleration of the aftershock. So this is not a nucleation process or a pre-slip process of the magnitude 9 earthquake. I'm sorry. So this is a summary, and I don't repeat this. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Time for a 15-second question. Chunji?
Speak up, please. I don't think so. Yeah, it doesn't change so much. okay, let's talk then.
Thank you. All right. The next presentation is entitled, it's on the map, right? Is Rupture Characterizations of the 2011 Magnitude 9 off the Pacific Coast of Tohoku Earthquake, and it's March 9th. Magnitude 7.44 shock constrained by an unprecedented data set for subduction earthquake by Xiao and G and Archuleta and Zhao, and presented by Xiao.
Just here, okay. Thank you. My name is Guangfu Xiao from UC Santa Barbara, and my topic is a focus on the rupture characterizations of the 2011 Tohoku earthquake and its foreshock. So this is a collaboration work with Professor Chen Ji and Professor Ralph Archuleta from UC Santa Barbara and Professor Dapeng Zhao from Tohoku University. So as you know, around the Tohoku earthquake occurred in a seismic active region. Actually, yes, pointer. Okay. So there are the black dots are the black background seismicity is from 1990s to 2009, and the white circles indicate all the M7 earthquakes from 800. As you can see, there's no earthquakes larger than 8.5 occurring in this region. The Tohoku earthquake started with the M7 foreshock, which occurred 2 days before the main shock. And during the M9 event, it ruptured the source regions of those historical M7 earthquakes. To the geoscience community, why an M9 earthquake can occur in a region rich in an M7 earthquake is not very clear. So in this study, we will start with force immersions for those foreshock and the main shock, and try to give possible explanations. We build the fault geometry based on the seismic profiles. So you can see there are three seismic profiles. We use a three fault segment as indicated by the white box, white boxes. And for each fault segment, it's further divided into smaller subfaults. Totally, there are 682 subfaults. And we use a 1D velocity model to calculate the Earth's response. The Tohoku earthquake is the best recorded subduction earthquake to date. We use almost all the data to constrain a source model. Here shows a tiny seismic station distribution, and we also use 28 KeyNet stations plus one, the closest KeyNet stations around here. And we also use the static displacement recorded at 325 GPS inland stations, as indicated by those blue rectangles, and also the five unique ocean bottom GPS stations, as indicated by the open black rectangles. Before we talking about the immersion result, I would like to show our checkerboard test. So this is our input checkerboard test. We're using the same immersion setup as we did for the Tohoku earthquake. So for each sleep patch, it consists of 16 subfaults. And the sleep amplitude is either 20 meter or 0 meter. Both the rupture velocity and the rise time are constant. In this study, we will focus two parameters. One is sleep, another is average sleep rate, which is defined as the ratio between the sleep and the rise time. And you can see overall, our inverted model fits the input model pretty good. They are very similar. If you calculate the spatial correlation, it's about 85% for the sleep and over 8% for the sleep rate. We also tested the sensitivities of ocean bottom GPS stations and the surface waves. If you remove the ocean bottom GPS, the resolution close to those stations will become lower, which is not a surprise. But if you remove the surface wave, actually the resolution close to trench will decrease. This figure shows our waveform fit for the real data, and because of a limited time, I only show the strong motion data. Black is the data, red is synthetic. The variance reduction is about 85%. And the frequency band is 3.3 to 50 seconds. This is our inverted sleep model. The color shows the sleep amplitude. And the red dots are the aftershocks occurring in 7 days. And you can see the large sleep are fused in those holes. Although there are some aftershocks occurred inside of the big sleep region, and we will explain them later. The total seismic moment of this event of our inverted sleep model is 5.36 times 10 to 22. Newton meter, consistent with the GCMT solution. And because the subfault with a large sleep amplitude are better constrained, so we calculated the average value with the sleep weighted. The average value for a sleeper is 30 meter. And this figure, we also compared our moment rate function with the high frequency P waves recorded at the LSA station, NASA station, which has azimuth location is almost perpendicular to the fault strike. So you can see they have a very good peak-to-peak match. One thing we want to point out is our update sleep model is very consistent with our preliminary model. Both the peak sleep amplitude and the extension of fall asleep. Let's look at the rupture process. So the red dots is aftershocks, and you can see the sleep is trying to fill in those holes. And the white line is a 1.5 kilometer reference rupture velocity, and the rupture bilaterally, and it will fill in those holes around here. The total duration is about 180 seconds. Let's look at in details. We separated them into 8 uneven slap shots. So the first one is shows the first 16 seconds. It shows a very slow initiation. In these 16 seconds, the released moment is equivalent to a M7.5 earthquake, a typical like a normal M7 earthquake in this region. But during 16 seconds and 22 seconds, we observed accelerated rupture towards to the southwest, and it's following a trend. It's following a aftershock trend here. Actually, you can see it goes to this direction. And actually, this breakout rupture is consistent with some of a high frequency back projection result, like Mohn's result. Then the ruptures propagate bilaterally, but in the down deep part, it seems have been arrested by this streak of aftershocks. And actually, those streak of aftershock is the upper bound of the 2005 and the 1978 Miyagi earthquake. And the rupture starts to break the near trench asperity at about 41 seconds. So at the beginning part, it ruptured very slow towards the trench. And after 22 seconds, the rupture goes through this barrier and rupture the Miyagi-Oki region again. And in the northern part, you can see there's a very slow rupture velocity, very slow ruptures. The average rupture velocity is only 0.8 kilometers per second. And in the southern part, it has a very heterogeneous ruptures. And actually, this is misadjusted fault segmentations in this region, as indicated by the 1978 Fukushima Oki earthquake, which include 5 M7 earthquakes ruptured separately and within 1 year from south to north. And this shows the distribution of inverted rise time and the sleep rate. The average rise time is 20 seconds, and the average sleep rate is about 1.3 meters per second. They are huge. But if you look at the foreshock, the M7 foreshock, 7.4 foreshock, those venues are very pretty small. It's like a typical venue of M7 earthquakes. We even calculated a static stress drop and the average apparent stress drop. Both of them are also very consistent with the values of other M7 earthquakes. Other M7 subduction earthquakes, sorry. But so the question is, during the M9 earthquake, it ruptured the source region of the M7 foreshock, and with a much larger sleep amplitude and a much larger sleep rate. The question is how to explain this. For sleep, it's quite easy because large sleep usually we can link to a large strain, so it may indicate a large static stress drop. And for the sleep rate, from a 2D static pulse-like crack propagation calculation issues, the slip rate is related with the dynamic stress drop. Dynamic stress drop is the effective stress that drives forward motions. So this dialogue shows stress and evolutions at one point of a forward surface. You have initial stress, and it will suddenly increase to a yield stress and drops to the sliding dynamic stress. And the difference between the initial stress and the sliding dynamic stress is called dynamic stress. Dynamic stress drop. So this suggests like for a large slip rate, it can link to a large dynamic stress drop. But the problem is it may indicate a large initiation stress, or it also could be a lower sliding stress drop. But based on a recent laboratory experiment, people like Han et al., they observed when you have a large slip rate, the sliding friction coefficient will drop a lot. So when you have a large slip rate, the sliding friction coefficient will become smaller. And so the sliding dynamic stress will be smaller, so which indicate a large dynamic stress drop. And we also compared our slip rate distribution with P-wave velocity anomalies at a lower bound of an uploading plate. It's a result based on Zhao et al.'s result. So for figure A, this one, you can the color indicate the slip rate, and the contours are the P-wave velocity anomalies in percentage. The numbers indicate the percentages. So you can see the high slip rate the region are correlated. It's correlated with high VP velocity regions. And since high VP indicate a strong region, usually indicate a strong material. So it has some relationship with a strong coupling in this region, may indicate. And actually, this is consistent with aftershock distribution. If you look at the slip rate and aftershocks, you can see most of aftershocks are located in a region with a lower slip rate. And the same thing for a background seismicity. And even for the 1978 Miyagi-Oki earthquake and the Shikoku-Oki earthquake. And so for the foreshock, if you look at the background seismicity, actually it occurred in a region reaches of a background seismicity, which is different from the region that indicated by that pink circles. And for the figures on the right, it shows the slip distribution of a foreshock with VP VS ratio anomalies. That is also based on the Zhao et al.'s result, and the number is in percentage. So since a high VP VS ratio usually indicate some fluid on over there, so it indicates actually this is a weak place. The foreshock occurred in a weak part of the fault interface. So here is our schematic model to explain both M7 and M9 earthquakes. So for those M7 earthquakes, it may be related with some weak part. And those weak part falls rupture more frequently, but is arrested by the surrounding stronger patch. And for the joint, and when the big, stronger part fails, it will be resulting in a huge earthquake or joint M9 earthquake like a Tohoku-Oki earthquake. And here's my conclusion. We got a pretty, we use all the data to resolve the slip distribution. We got a very complex rupture process. And we found the abnormal aftershocks correlated with our rupture process, actually. And the slip rate is correlated with high VPVS slip. Maybe that's it. Thanks.
We have time for a question. Born.
I don't think there's any strong correlation between the sleep rate and the high frequency radiation, because high frequency radiation is based on velocity, and usually that is correlated with sleep acceleration. It's not a sleep rate. And the last thing is, if the sleep rate is pretty smooth, although it's pretty big, it did not radiate the high frequency out.
All right. Our next presentation is inversion of high rate, one sample per second GPS data for rupture process of the March 11th Tohoku-Oki earthquake, magnitude 9.1, by Yue and Lei. And the presenter is Yue.
Thank you, Mark. And good afternoon, everybody. Today, I will present a finite fault model of the Tohoku-Oki earthquake inverted from the high rate GPS data. And this work was directed by my advisor, Thorn Lei. I think everybody accepts it's the best observed earthquake until now. One of the reasons may be the near field displacement is well recorded by the dense and high rate continuous GPS data deployed in the Japan Islands. So what does that data seem like? Okay, this animation shows the ground displacement of the horizontal and the vertical displacement of each station. And we can see after the earthquake happened, the seismic waves will travel through the networks. And finally, it will evolve into a static displacement. When we get waveforms of one station, it will be seems like this. It will ramp up at some time and undergoes some vibration and finally left over with a static displacement. And before we make an inversion with that, we expect to have some achieve some advantage from this data set. First, the waveform, which is the dynamic part, will provide a good spatial resolution. As we know, for the finite fault model, the spatial resolution is always controlled by the apparent horizontal velocity. And for the tel-seismic data, the apparent horizontal velocity is high, so it doesn't have that much high spatial resolution. But for the near field data, the main dynamic energy is controlled by the undispersed Rayleigh waves, which has a low apparent velocity. So we expect high spatial resolution from the dynamic part. And another thing is that we can get a good constraint about the seismic moment by the static displacement. In this session, a lot of people will present their finite fault models based on the seismic data or the geodetic data. But no matter how, they were using part of the ground displacement. And my goal here is to exploit the complete ground motion with both the dynamic and static offsets. But what kind of Green's function can we use for inversion, which includes this part, which is dynamic, and the leftover with the static? What we choose is the normal mode summation, the normal mode of which is calculated from the prime model and up to 80 millihertz. And it will include both these parts. Okay? And then it's the data selection and the grade parameter fault model parameterization part. From the station first available to Earth, which is 400 stations, we choose 40 of them. And the hypocenter location was chosen from obtained from Zhao's relocation paper. And the fault plane geometry has 202 degree strike, and the dip was on multi-dip segment. And we grade 20 grades along strike and 10 grades along dip, so totally there will be 200 grades. And the dimension of each subfault will be 20 by 20 square kilometers. For the source time function of each subfault, we use seven triangles to fit the any shape of source time function. And with 10 seconds up and 10 seconds down, so totally it can fit as long as 80 seconds long source time function for each subfault. Rupture velocity was set for was used to calculate the turn up time for each subfault. And this rupture velocity we selected was from the back projection data, which is 1.5 kilometers per second within the first 100 kilometers and then 2.5 kilometers per second outside that. And the two sleep vectors was used for inversion with a rig of 45 to 135 degrees. Because we used the non-negative least square inversion, to our Green's function, so any vector between these two range will be fitted. Okay, we get the three component data in the data matrix, and then Green's function in the inversion matrix, and then we merge a regulation matrix. We can also call it the smoothing weight to the Green's function matrix. Here we use the first order smoothing weight, which constrain the displacement of the moment of adjacent subfault to be continuous, and the amplitude of it, the smoothing vector is calculated from the sum power of the Green's functions as also the dimension of the subfaults. And we use the non-negative least square, non-negative least square method to solve this problem, which is described in this paper, in this book. And for our inversion matrix, which is scaled with several thousand by tens of several thousand dimensions, it takes 2 hours for one inversion. Here is our preferred model. And first, the rupture array was prescribed in the 200 by 200 square kilometers area. And the maximum slip happens in the updip part, which is around 60 meter. And the sum of the seismic moment is equal to a magnitude 9.1 earthquake. And the lower map, okay, neural map shows the source time function for each subfault. So these gray polygons shows the source time function. And the background color map shows the contour of the centroid time of each subfault. And we know when the source time centroid time contour is more discrete, it means the large area will rupture in a relatively short time. But when it's more dense, it means it shows more like a propagation pattern. So we can discriminate that the updip shows more like a crack-like, which is the large area ruptured in a relatively short time, and the downdip shows more like a propagation pattern. We can also notice in the center part, the source time function of each subfault shows two peaks. It means it has two main ruptures. This may be more obvious in these sleep history cartoons. We can see from 50 seconds to 70 seconds, the updip area actually rupture together with a large sleep and relatively long source time function. And the center of a little bit to the downdip part actually have the first rupture between 30 to 40 seconds. And then it seems like driven by the updip large sleep and have another sleep between 70 to 80 seconds. There was also a lob propagated to the source from 80 to 100 seconds. Okay, after we obtain the result, we need to discuss about the solution stabilities. There are a lot of parameters that have potential impaction to our station stability, solution stability, and I listed all of them here. And in our test, we found our main rupture pattern is stable with most of them, including the rupture velocity. But it may be mostly impacted by the smoothing weight. For most inversion problems, the smoothing weight has a critical effect to the inverse result. And we know when the smoothing weight is higher, we tend to invert with a larger sleep area but smaller maximum sleep. Some people use the trade-off curves to optimize a smoothing weight. What we do here is to find a smoothing weight which will produce the maximum sleep to be close to the ocean bottom displacement amplitude, which is observed by the ocean bottom surveys. So it's kind of physical constraint to that. To the inversion of the tail seismic data, the rupture velocity always have an important influence to the result pattern. And when the rupture velocity is high, it tends to invert with a larger sleep area and with smaller sleep amount. Here we play with rupture velocity from 1.5 kilometers per second to 2.5 or 3 kilometers per second. But the sleep pattern seems pretty stable, including the centroid time contour seems almost the same. In one test, we set the rupture velocity to be infinite, which means all the subfaults was turned up in the same time, but the sleep pattern is still similar to each other. Okay, after make an inversion with only the dynamic GPS data, we make some other achievements with the joint inversion with both the GPS data as also the tau-seismic data. And here I show some preliminary result. And here is our previous data, and here is the joint inversion data. The sleep pattern seems not exactly the same, but generally the similar pattern, which has largest sleep area in the up deep, and then down deep it's much wider, including the central time counter. So the similar pattern, which is more discreted in the up deep and more dense in the down deep. It may be related to the difference in the radiation energy, difference in the frequency of the radiated energy, difference between the up deep and down deep. Okay, here is the waveform fitting. We can fit both the GPS data as also the tau seismic PV data. Okay, here is the conclusion. To the inversion method, I think the complete fitting of both the dynamic and static part can provide good spatial resolution as also the constraint of seismic moment. To the earthquake, what we can learn from our model is that the up-deep area tends to sleep in a large area and relatively long sustained function, and the down-deep tends to sleep with a propagation pattern with relatively short sustained function. That may have some indication about the different radiation frequencies between these two parts. Thank you.
Other questions? So I have a question. Do you consider any effect of structural heterogeneity near the trench? Do you consider such an effect in the Green functions?
Oh, we didn't constrain that effect in our Green function because we used a 1D prime model. And actually, we filtered both the data and our Green's function in a really low frequency, which is 0.04 or 0.08. And in that frequency, I think the Earth model is pretty close to prime. Then I only fit this low frequency data.
Okay. Any other question? Okay, so thank you very much. So we move on to the next talk. Next talk will be provided by, presented by Laurent and many other authors, and the title is The 11 March 2011 Tohoku-Oki Earthquake from GPS Ground Deformation to Ionospheric Perturbations.
Thank you, Chairman. So, good afternoon. I'm Lucie Roland. This talk deals with observations made in the ionosphere just after the Tohoku-Oki earthquake. These results are from recent research made within the group of ionospheric seismology in IPGP in Paris, the group of Philippe Lognonet, and also most recently in GeoAzure and University of Nice. I would like to also here to acknowledge the participation of other persons from Brazil and also Japan and the GSI for providing high-rate GPS data. So this nice picture here shows actually atmospheric gravity waves effect of clouds, and this kind of waves are responsible for the observations we are showing next. So, as you know, many observations are used from different techniques to constrain the seismic rupture, like INSAR accelerometers, and also tsunami measurements and seafloor geodesy. here you have kinematic wireless GPS showing in color code the vertical movements of the ground. And we are looking for the relationship between those vertical displacement and the atmospheric displacement just above. And that can be shown here by pressure measurements. And we will highlight this interaction between solid Earth and atmosphere using ionospheric measurements. Why ionospheric measurements? So what we know there is when a rupture is propagated, it produced vertical displacement and also vibrations of the atmosphere just above. It produced a pressure pulse that propagates upward, and due to the decreasing air density, the atmospheric waves produced have their amplitude that is strongly amplified up to the ionized part of the atmosphere in the upper atmosphere here, which is located for our measurements around 250 kilometers. The earthquakes also produce Rayleigh and tsunami waves that can be observed at teleseismic distance, and that in turn also produced acoustic pressure waves and also other kind of waves concerning tsunami waves as gravity waves. So the what happened when the atmospheric neutral waves reach the upper part of the atmosphere is that the neutral particle collides charged particles and induce change in electron density. This electron density fluctuations infer a delay actually in the GPS radio waves and the two send to receiver, and due to the dispersive effect of the ionospheric plasma, we can infer the integrated quantity of the electrons on the receiver ray path. So I remind here at the bottom of the slide the formula for TEC, which is so the integrated part of electron density between the GPS receiver and the satellite. When we have when chance, we can have a satellite that is inclined and that can sound the part of the ionosphere just above the epicenter, like the satellite on the right. So what we do is to locate these ionospheric fluctuations at the intersection between the ionospheric thin layer and the satellite ray path. So when you have, like in the case of Japan, lots of GPS receivers, you can make images of the fluctuations of the ionosphere. So here, I will show you a movie showing the fluctuations of the ionosphere after the earthquake. Here you are at the origin time of the earthquake, and you will see a few minutes later a burst propagating fast, and then also much slower concentric waves propagating away from the epicenter. So here, the burst appears and then atmospheric waves interact with ionosphere and propagating away from the epicenter. So this talk deals with the analysis of these waves and also propose some ideas to use those kind of observations for rupture constraints. So what we use here to analyze the observations is the solid Earth atmospheric normal mode, we use actually extended Earth with atmosphere. So as you can see here in green are the normal modes of the solid Earth, classically computed. And you have also other modes that are atmospheric modes here in blue, divided in two parts. One part in with high frequency in acoustic modes, and one part with lower frequency are gravity modes. What you see here is that the green, for instance, that the green Rayleigh waves modes are overlapping the acoustic waves. So I represented on the right the ionospheric perturbation as function and time in x-axis and in y-axis epicentral range. As you can see, we have different wave packets propagating more or less fast. So for instance, the most propagating wave in the gray continuous line propagate at 3.5 kilometers per second. This is bound to Rayleigh waves. Those Rayleigh coupled waves are acoustically coupled with the solid Earth. So those kind of waves were formerly observed in the case here of the Denali earthquake using the same technique, and most recently for the Wenchuan earthquake, where we made a model reconstructing fairly well the measurements. In the case of Tohoku-Oki earthquake, we make here direct comparison between the GPS high resolution ground, vertical ground displacement on the left and the ionospheric perturbation on the right. What you can see here are the propagating Rayleigh waves and a good agreement with the ionospheric perturbations highlighted here by the round. And what is interesting here is the 10 minutes delay, which is the delay for the atmospheric wave to reach the ionosphere. This wave propagating at sound speed. So you see also other different waves that we will have to examine further. So in the actually the vertical displacement on the ground also excites atmospheric modes that are presented here. What we represent above is a time series of a specific receiver, and we can see oscillations that have energy peak at two specific frequencies, who are the frequencies of resonance of the low atmospheric waveguide. So it was also observed in the case of Sumatra Andaman earthquake, and in the case of Pinatubo eruption. Other kind of waves are gravity waves who have a lower period, and with their restoring force is gravity. And so we represent here the normal modes for the gravity waves and highlight the first slow wave packet that we can interpret those wave packets as gravity trap modes that are showing there. Other kind of waves that are well known also are oceanic modes that interact directly with the atmosphere and produce gravity, upward propagating gravity waves. And what we highlight with this study is that the tsunami signal is arriving a little bit later because of the slower propagation due to the tsunami forcing. This is also corroborated by former observations that I showed here in the case of the Peru tsunami. You can see the wave, gravity wave induced by the tsunami arriving from the east. And this corroborates the velocity that we highlight for this wave. Another interesting and very interesting signal is the very first arrival of the signal. So what we see here is the very first perturbation that we detected with this method using high rate GPS data. So as you can see, the very first signal arrived not from the epicenter. It also what's also interesting is that it arrives quite early after the earthquake. So we have here the direct print of the vertical displacement of the rupture. And we made a comparison with the USGS preliminary model, who locate the maximum of the slip near the epicenter. And after 3 days, you see that the rupture is much more constrained and it's closer to the trench. This corroborates actually the measurements in the ionosphere. So as first conclusion, we have here a more precise classification for co-seismic ionospheric waves. This is limited to a certain frequency band, and we have to extend the study to other periods. And other conclusions is about using those kind of observation for seismological applications and to better understand actually the coupling mechanisms between Earth and atmosphere and ionosphere during earthquakes and tsunami. And also we could, I hope I will, I have highlighted that we can use this observation for source analysis. And we are working on this subject now. And this would be also useful for early warning and will allow imaging of a seismic fault slip. So you will be able to see more information about this at the poster session on Friday. I thank you.
Thank you very much. Questions? Yes.
What's the processing time to come up with that map of variable displacement?
So outside the collecting time for data, the processing is very very fast, and a few minutes, 1 or 2 minutes, are enough to obtain this kind of images.
Other questions? Okay. So thank you very much. The next talk is given by Tsuboi-san, and the title is Source Process and Broadband Waveform Modeling of 2011 Tohoku Earthquake Using Spectral Remnant Method.
Thank you. Thank you, Chairman. In this presentation, I'd like to show our forward modeling experiments for the seismic waves and some related observation for that. First of all, I'd like to show our rupture model that we obtained by inverting the teleseismic body waves. These are done by the conventional technique such as the Kikuchi and Kanamori, and we obtained the very large slip here, just close to the trench. Here we estimated that the maximum slip is 49 meter, and also the rupture start from here to propagate to this direction, and then bidirectionally it propagates along the trench. And we should also mention that the rupture velocity that we obtain is rather slow, such as 2.0 kilometer per second. So we should mention that our rupture model is basically the same as those obtained by various researchers that presented in this session. And we have a very large slip along the trench, and also the rupture velocity is quite slow. And rupture duration is about 150 seconds, and also the comparable value with other models. And this map shows the location of these slip distribution along this trench section. Then first, we have calculated the synthetic seismograms by using the spectral element technique, which is the type of the finite element technique. And we can include various features of the three-dimensional Earth model. And we divide the Earth into these kind of small blocks. And for each small block, we calculate displacement and then forward by finite difference type of the integration of the time. And in doing this calculation, we used the Earth simulator of JAMSTEC. At this moment, we now have Earth simulator 2, which has 160 nodes. And for this calculation, we used 91 nodes of Earth simulator 2, which has 726 processors. And the number of grid points is 13 billion. And the horizontal grid spacing at the surface is 0.018 degree. So the accuracy of the synthetics is up to 3.5 seconds. Then I'd like to compare our synthetics with observation. This is the typical example of our comparison for the observation and the synthetics. The red traces are the synthetics that we calculated by spectral element technique, and the black traces are the observation for the Grafenberg in Germany. This is the broadband seismograms, and band was filtered at 10 to 5 and second. And this is the east-west and north-south and up and vertical component. So both the body waves, P and S waves, can be modeled well, and also the surface waves, RAP and Rayleigh traces are modeled well by this synthetics. And some of the wave packets are shifted because of the three-dimensional model that we used is not perfect. It's a very smooth global model. So at some point, travel time does not match with the observation. And this is another example for our comparison. And this is the station at Samo Islands called Ahiamaru. And in this case, you may say that these surface wave arrivals do not model well in this synthetics. But in this case, the bandpass filter is between 10 seconds and 500 seconds. So these surface wave traces are dominated by the 20 second surface waves. But to model this kind of short period surface waves, we need to have a good cluster structure. And again, velocity model that we used is a global velocity model and cannot model this kind of cluster structure well. But if we use much longer period band of filtering, this is the band of filtering between 200 second and 500 second, then the agreement between the synthetics and observation is quite good. So it means that at the longer frequency, longer period, the synthetics models the observation very well. So I think that the rupture model that we used grasps the entire rupture model quite well. And also, this is another example for the synthetics that we calculated for the very close distance stations in the coast of the Tohoku region. This is the synthetics for the Kesennuma station for the FNET station. Actually, observation is clipped, so we cannot compare this synthetic with observation. But there is a static displacement because of this cross displacement station. And east-west component moves about 3 meters to east, and also there is 1 meter subsidence at this point. So not 1 meter, but almost 7 centimeters. But this kind of static displacement is quite compatible, both pattern and amount, with the crustal deformation observed co-seismically for this event. So we may say that our model grasps the entire feature of the rupture because both in the teleseismic distance and also the very close epicentral distance, the synthetics that we calculated can simulate the seismic waveforms quite well. So again, I should mention that our model have some peculiar characteristics that we have a very large sweep here along the trench. Yeah, maximum sweep is around 49 meters, and also the rupture velocity is quite slow. Then, after I have submitted this abstract, I was wondering, is there any indication of this kind of peculiar unusual rupture along this region that might be observed by some kind of geophysical observation? And I should apologize that I didn't mention anything about that in the abstract, but after that I did some check of the observer data, and I'd like to show something about that. And I'm from the JAMSTEC, and I suppose you know about the JAMSTEC is, and JAMSTEC operates several research vessels and conducts a huge amount of research cruises around Japanese islands. And most of the data are open to everybody from our website of the data center. And I have checked very carefully about the research cruises made by JAMSTEC research vessels, and found that two cruises of the research vessel Mirai passes almost the same region of the earthquake rupture area, 3 months separation. And in this case, red cruise track is the MR1006 in November 2010, and the green traces are the also the Mirai research cruise MR1102, and it passes this region in February 2011, so just 1 month before the earthquake. And both research cruises conducted the geophysical observation along the track. And in this figure, you may find that most these two cruise tracks coincide almost each other, but of course, there is small difference in the cruise track, and that separation in the horizontal distance is 2 kilometers at most. And 2 kilometers might be large, so it depends on what you think. But I'd like to show you the geophysical observation of the sea surface gravity measurement done by these cruises. In this case, red dots are the surface gravity measurement for the MR1106, which is February 2011, and the black dots are for the November 2010. And we measure the relative gravity along the track, but it is calibrated at land when returned to the port, so we can get the absolute gravity here in the lower panel, and upper panel is a free air anomaly in millibars. And you can find that at the region with the latitude 36.5 to 37.5, you may have slight gravity measurement, gravity increase in the February 2011, 1 month before the earthquake. And the order of the increase is several milligrams at most. And this kind of observation might be quite sensitive to various effect, so we should check very carefully what causes this kind of gravity increase. And one point, of course, is that the in this case, anyway, the sea surface gravity measurement shows that free air anomaly of MR11C2 shows several millimeter increase compared to MR1006. just above the rupture area. And the distance of the cruise track is at most 2 kilometers. And in this case, of course, if the bathymetry of the if bathymetry changes rapidly, it causes the gravity change at the surface. But this area it has not so rough bathymetry. So I suppose that this amount of gravity change is not yielded by the cruise track difference. And of course, we should be very careful about the oceanic current. And when I showed this observation to an oceanographer in Jamstek, he immediately pointed out that there should be an oceanic current change during this period. And actually, the crucial current went up to north in November 2010 and went back to south in February 2011. It means that the sea surface increases in November and then decreases in February. So the decrease of the sea surface height shows the increase of the gravity. But the sea surface height change due to oceanic current is at most 2 to 3 meters. And if we calculate very simple calculation, this kind of amount of the sea surface height change will not yield also this amount of gravity change. So we have to check very carefully, but there may be an density increase inside the Earth that causes this kind of surface gravity change just before the earthquake. And if we interpret this gravity change as a density increase along the fault surface, it shows that about 1 gram per cubic centimeter density increase may cause this size of the gravity change at the sea surface. Okay, to summarize my talk, our source rupture model is characterized by slow rupture velocity and large slip. And synthetic seismograms computed for the model reproduces observable data both for teleseismic and cross distance station. So we think that this model grasps the entire rupture characteristics of the this earthquake. And sea surface gravity measurement showed that there might be a gravity increase of several milligrams above the rupture area before the main shock, which might be interpreted as density increase along the fault surface. That's all. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. We have time for a few questions. Yes, Son?
I used the entire fault rupture model.
You calculated the spectral element solution for one subfault?
Yeah.
You could do it in 9 hours, you could do several hundred of them?
To calculate for the entire group. No. Each subfault can be distributed along the surface, and then we could calculate simultaneously at one time. Just one simulation produces those finite fault movement and then the waveforms all over the globe. Do I answer your question?
I think I should talk to you later.
Other questions? Is there any plan for a gravity survey over the area?
Everywhere you mean?
around the source region.
After the earthquake. We should have the same track before the earthquake. And also, I think that we should use the same instrument. And it is difficult.
Okay, so thank you very much. Other questions? So if not, I would like to conclude this session today. But I would like to remind you that this special session will continue tomorrow morning. Tomorrow morning we have two sessions. Also, there will be a geodesy session in the tomorrow afternoon, and also the poster session on Friday. So thank you very much for coming, and thank you very much for our good discussion presentations.